Boa noite. Nós vamos começar a nossa comunhão com oração. Gostaríamos então que casais, dois a dois.
Good evening. Let us pray two by two. Pray before the Lord so that before the Lord we may be opened to receive His word, and that this word may produce building and especially change in our person and change in our living. Amen? So let us spend a few minutes in prayer, two by two, couples opening up before the Lord. Amen. We thank the Lord for this conference. And in this conference, whose subject is the divine economy. It is a very special conference because in this conference, God is presenting to us something which is in His heart, something which is of His eternal plan. And from the first day of the conference, we were impacted with the word of the Lord. We saw right in the beginning the importance of being people filled with faith, love, and hope, not only toward the Lord, but also toward people around us. And of course, when we are now in this fellowship with couples, we may realize that these three elements, faith, love, and hope, are essential for couples in God's eternal plan. I'd like to hear, if you've been here yesterday night in parents' talk, please raise your hand. Amen. This is important. Why? Because actually this fellowship is a fellowship that adds up to the fellowship from yesterday. Yesterday we saw in a very clear way, according to the word of God, that man is in his eternal plan. But when he created man, the Bible records in Genesis chapter 1 that he created him in a very special way. Genesis 1:27 reads, created male and female. So we can see that not only man is in God's plan, but also the women. But it doesn't stop there. Why? Because in verse 28 in Genesis 1 reads, God blessed them and said, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Here we have our children, right? Right in the beginning of the Bible, we see that God's eternal plan comprises husband, wife, and children. This is great. This means that our family is part of God's eternal plan. Something which is in God's heart. Isn't that wonderful? This is wonderful. Now, man was created in a very special way, as we know. Man was created to be after God's image and likeness, and also to have dominion, which means the kingdom. If this was in God's plan in the beginning, I'd like to say that this plan continues. This plan did not change. Meaning what? That this plan is for our household. This is God's plan for our homes. This needs to be something strong recorded in our hearts. This family must carry God's image, God's likeness, and God's dominion. Yesterday, we also saw that after God created man, He said that man should eat. Eat is what? To put within. Within himself. You eat, you put something within yourself. So, God cares about what we are putting in our inner being. Then, when God established a limit for man, he said, certain things you cannot put within. If you do it, you will die, right? We saw this yesterday. I'm just quickly reviewing it because today we'll be advancing a bit more in this vision. Yesterday was a word for parents. Of course, parents are a couple. Today we'll be looking at a more broad aspect. So God established a limit, what you were to put within yourself. And of course, God's plan is to have God within us, right? And this became real after with the work of redemption. Because one day, we believed in the Lord, and we received the Lord, and the Lord entered into us. God's life has entered into us. The Spirit has entered into us. This means that this point in God's plan could be fulfilled. Right? God's life entered into us. Now, we need, as families, as a couple, to have a deep realization that this life of God must be manifested in our homes. Of course, for this life to be manifested in our homes, we need to live in spirit, because if we live in the flesh, we'll be expressing Adam. If we live in spirit, we'll be expressing Christ. We also saw that for this to be fulfilled, man and woman, the couple, must be working together. God, in Genesis 2:18, said, it's not good that man, for the man to be alone. I will make him, make a helper suitable for him. So when God said that it's not good that man, for man to be alone, he was touching the need of man. But when he says, I will make a helper suitable for him, he was covering God's need. Because God has a plan for man, God has a plan for couples. And for this plan to be fulfilled, it is necessary the cooperation of both. That's why we have the term helper, because it's a mission that can only be carried out if both work together. This here, what I'm saying is a basic principle, is a foundation, is a base. It is something that cannot be missed in any place, in any family. And God also said to man that man should keep and cultivate the garden. The garden is a realm of life, and all the sphere of life must be cultivated. Your home, your family is a garden. There's a need to cultivate it and to keep it. But what happens today is that people are not cultivating and are just trying to keep it. It's impossible to keep without cultivating it. We saw this yesterday. So it's important to cultivate and to keep it, to make life grow. And of course, all this, as said in the message tonight, all this becomes real in spirit. That's why the importance of being in spirit. And we all have the spirit. The problem is that we do not use our spirit. We live in a very natural way. We live in ourselves because we feel that at home we have the freedom to be what we are. And then we have a great conflict. What are you? You have two options. Adam or Christ. What are you? Right? If you are in your flesh, you would be Adam. If you are in spirit, you would be Christ. Because God's life is to be manifested and expressed in me. God's life is to be manifested in my life. What is important, dear saints, is that we need to realize if we are living in spirit, this spirit, which is the all-inclusive spirit, brings in him divine and human elements. Brings in the uplifted humanity of Christ. If you say, I'm in spirit, but there's nothing human, so you're not in spirit. Do you understand this? Because if the spirit is an all-inclusive spirit, right? God became a man, there was incarnation, there was a human living, right? He became a man, right? There was a human living, he uplifted the human living, human virtues, right? So, if I am in spirit, I have a transformed humanity, I have an uplifted humanity. I can be husband in spirit or a husband in the flesh. If I am a husband in spirit, I will have the divine element, but I will also have the human element and with an uplifted humanity. Our problem is that when we are in ourselves, the humanity manifested in our home is a very low humanity. That's why the importance of the cooperation of both to cultivate and to keep.
So
then we also saw two lines about the descendants. Because of the fact that Cain lived far away from God's presence, hiding from God, and to be a fugitive and wanderer, he begot a descendant whose years and whose days were not recorded before God. But when we see the descendants, Seth, Genesis 4:26 reads, 26 read, Seth also had a son, and he named him Enosh, and that at that time people began to call on the name of the Lord. Then the Bible records the genealogy of Adam, the descendant that came through Seth. Pay attention to this genealogy. Our God is a God from generation to generation. Because God, in Genesis 1:28, he said that they should to be fruitful, multiply, and fill the earth. He was saying that man should carry and propagate his image from generation to generation to rule up to filling the whole earth. Our God is a God of generation from generation. We also saw yesterday about the importance, the bond between each generation. We saw then God is the God of Abraham. When God spoke with Isaac, he said, I am the God of Abraham, your father. What does it mean that Isaac knew the work, the history of his father? He said, I'm the God of Abraham, God of your father. He was saying to Isaac that the whole experience now should be inherited and carried on by him. Later, when speaking with Jacob, he said he was the God of Abraham, Isaac, and God of Isaac. And now, it was coming to Jacob an inheritance of two generations. Later on in Exodus, when we see God appearing to Moses, saying, I'm the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, showing that our God is a God from generation to generation, and each generation gains more experience before the Lord. And in the past, we studied this when we spoke of God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, speaking of a thorough experience, right? Experience of a family, the experience of a people, of a family becoming a people. And yesterday, Ezra added about this matter of God of generation, from generation to generation, meaning a continuity. Why are we saying this? Because in this conference, this is speaking of God's eternal plan, and that now came, it's our turn, as shared in this message. Now it's us, right? We are the ones. It's our turn to receive an inheritance and to pass it on to the next generation, what we received, added to our experiences. You know, this experience in the end of times, it's an experience extremely important. Why is this? Because it's an experience that will bring the Lord back. It's an experience of conclusion, experience of closing, complementing. Do you believe the Lord's return is near? If you do, then you know we'll be fulfilling this experience in such a way that the Lord will say, they're ready, let me return. Right? And where are we receiving this experience? At home. Because at home, we manifest who we really are. What we manifest in our meetings, it's not reliable. Do you think it's reliable? It's not reliable. Now, what we manifest at home is what we really are. Right? I'd like you to say to your spouse, you are what you are at home. Say to your spouse. Are you ashamed? But it's a fact. Isn't that so? Well, we saw the importance of a genealogy, and the Bible records the genealogy of Jesus, the genealogy that brought the Lord for the first time. And today, because we are living in the end of times, the word, the message tonight is extremely strong. It's a calling for us. We must be the last generation in the genealogy of Christ in His second coming, right? This is what we need to realize. This is what we need to see, and this is what we desire also. We need to yearn before the Lord. Well, we saw then the importance of having faith, love, and hope according to what was spoken of in this conference about God, the divine economy. Now, I'd like to see with you, brothers and sisters, a few essential aspects for our living in the end of times. Let us take a look at 1 Peter. Chapter 3. Before entering into this, I'd like to say something. Yesterday also, we shared that because we're living in the end of times, the ministry of iniquity, the mystery of iniquity is operating. And we cannot deny that because of the fact that the mystery of iniquity is operating, we are influenced. What is the best way for you to realize if you are suffering or not, the influence of the iniquity. It is by the temperature of your love toward the Lord and toward the church and toward your family. Why? Because Matthew 24:12 says that by multiplying the iniquity, the love of almost all will grow cold. It is very difficult for you to find out if you are suffering the influence of iniquity. So just apply, the temperature gauge of love. It's cold. It's a sign of what? Suffered the influence of iniquity. Right? We're not speaking of theories or doctrines, we're speaking of reality. What is like your love toward the Lord? The love of both of you toward the Lord. The love of both of you toward the church. And the love of both of you toward one another. What is the temperature like? This is how we know our real condition. And you know, when we feel that we are alarmed. I was visiting another country, fellowshipping with a couple, and I shared this. And they were alarmed. I did not know. Dear saints, dear couple, we have the Spirit within us. It is possible to be healed. It is possible to leave the situation. It is possible to be recovered to a normal situation before God. Now, when we speak about a couple, the greatest problem out there is the matter of relationship. This is a fact. How is a couple relating to each other? In the past, we already studied in a fellowship for couples the importance of heading up. If there is the heading up of Christ in our homes, our relationship is through Christ, right? It's not a direct relationship. It's a relationship through Christ, passing through the head. When a relationship passes through the head, peace and harmony and cooperation reigns. But if it's a direct relationship, then we have problems. Now, if I am in spirit, if I am joined to the Lord and to become one spirit with Him, then it is possible to have a good relationship. It is good to be filled with love. Why? Because this Spirit brings in Himself an uplifted humanity and proper humanity. Do not look. I will not say do not look. It may be that the situation between you two may not be very good. Do not worry about it. If you exercise your spirit, if you live in spirit, your fellowship will be recovered and your relationship will be very, very good. It's all a matter of heading up.
But a few points I'd like to highlight with you, dear couples. In 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. I believe that this is very important for the end of times that we are living. Here in the beginning speaks for women, but actually we'll be applying this for couples. It's good both for men and women because speaking of a spiritual principle. Verse 1 reads, "Wives, in the same way, submit yourselves to your own husbands, so that..." Of course, in other epistles, in Paul's epistles, for this verse, for women, there's also a verse for women and for men, right? Also speaking for women to be submissive, and for husbands, speaks about loving. Husband must love the wife, and woman must be submissive to the husband. Now let's leave this this for a moment and go through a spiritual principle. Here reads that maybe if any of them do not believe the word, they may be won over without words by the behavior of their wives. Let's apply this principle for both, meaning what? That if your spouse do not obey the word, maybe win over without words by the behavior of, by your behavior, it is a very important verse. We like to win over with words, right? We have a problem, and then begins this duel of words, the discussion of words. We want to convince. We use the word. Here we read, stop speaking. Stop using the word. Win over without words by your behavior. What do you think about it? What? Are you in? This is the word of God. Is this possible or not? Can you believe in this or not? Do you? Or you will say, oh, for my husband or wife, this doesn't work. No, it doesn't work. It does or not? What? Can you believe it? It works? Let me tell you something. If you do not believe, your unbelief will stop God's operation. Am I right? Matthew 13:58. And he did not do many miracles there because of their lack of faith. You know why many problems happen in the home? Because you do not believe in the word of God. So let me ask again. Do you believe it's possible to win over your spouse without words, just with their behavior? What? Can you really believe it? If you do, this will happen. If you do not believe, this will not happen. Good. Arguments will stop. Right? Because you believe, This is what was spoken in the first message in this conference. I'm applying it in a practical way. Faith, love, and hope. Right? You love and you believe that God will change. That's why you are patient. Why are you patient? Because you have hope. Wasn't that so with Onesimus, right? Your spouse is an Onesimus. I'm applying the word of this conference, saints. If you do not believe it, then you're throwing this conference away. Look at your spouse and say, you're my Onesimus. Some couples do not want to say it, and you see, this is a hard thing. So we are stubborn, and then we blame God. In the first message, God sent the message, faith, love, and hope, and you go like, amen, amen, faith, love, and hope for everyone outside, but not for my place. For my spouse, God forbid, and you still call the name of God in vain. Where is the first place that you have to apply the word of Onesimus? Isn't it in your place with your spouse? So let me tell you, say it to your spouse, you're my Onesimus, say it. Now it's a bit better, not so good yet, but it's better. Do you think that Paul went over Onesimus with many words? What? Wasn't it that he manifested in a practical way in love? What is perseverance and what is hope, faith, love, and hope in your place? Why is this? Because we have spirits. Because the Lord dwells in us. Of course, we in ourselves, we have no way. We in ourselves, we do not accept it. But Christ lives in us. Right? There's Christ living in us. This God loves us. He's patient with us, right? And that's plenty of patience. Many times we say, oh, how come God is so patient with me? You did not give up. And that song we sing, the Lord insists on making me reign. Can you believe he's insisting? I'm useless. I'm an Onesimus. I'm nothing but his insisting on making me reign. So God insists on making you reign and making your spouse to reign. So look, win over without a word by your behavior, faith, love, and hope. Verse 2, we're looking at your behavior full of fear. This is true. This is sincere. Full of fear, meaning my spouse is a God-fearing person. What a wonderful person. He has fear of God. God governs him. Look how wonderful this is. Let me assure you, you will be loving your spouse even more. So let's go to verse 3 and 4. 1 Timothy 3:3. Not give. So as you see in the spiritual principles for both, It's not, man does not care much about gold, but man has many other things, right? Computer, in the cell phone, in the car, right? They're different. It's a different adornment, but man also has his own adornment. So the Lord is saying for us, what is important, this is not worth it, okay? I'm not saying for you to, you know, cut some slack or to be laid back. This is not important. It's actually verse 4. The man of the heart, this is what God looks. The man of the heart joined to incorruptible, a spirit meek and tranquil. Pay attention to this word, spirit meek and tranquil.
This
is of great value before God. It's precious before God. You know this?
The
spirit
is
precious for God.
It's
something that God treasures. Do you have this spirit? You have in your spirit joined the Spirit of the Lord. It's quiet and full of submission. The problem is not in your spirit, it's in your soul life. Your soul life is like that. No, it's not. But the spirit is precious before God. You know what that is, to be precious before God? Means that God looks at it and says, how wonderful this is. I really love this. I really appreciate this. You may choose it. You may choose to be mad. To think of what God would say, or you may choose to exercise your spirit, to have a spirit very tranquil in all that situation, quiet spirit, a gentle and quiet spirit, and God will even call the angels and say, look at that, a gentle and quiet spirit, look at that, this is precious. Great worth in God's sight. So, now let's go to verse 7. Husbands, in the same way, be considerate as you live with your wives. Here, there should be a common ground. So there is, they have fellowship, they have, it's common, they are all participating, so that is why it is considerate as you live with your wives. How the enemy destroys families, destroying this considerate way of living. Yesterday in fellowship was shared what? That God's enemy wants to break the bond between the generations, right? This is the crest work of the enemy, to break the bond between generations. In such a way that the God's inheritance may not be passed on to the next generation. But it's important to live, considerate your life at home as you live with your wives, with discernment. This is for what? Is to preserve your this considerate lives at home, Whenever the Spirit of God is, there is fellowship. This is a principle in the Word. This is a principle of God's action. If I am filled with the Spirit, I desire for fellowship, right? Do you believe someone to say, I'm filled with the Spirit, but I don't want to fellowship with anybody? Can you believe that? This is a sign that is not filled with the Spirit. Because those who are filled with the Spirit has fellowship. Keep in fellowship.
Tendo consideração para com a vossa mulher como a parte mais frágil.
And respect as weaker partner.
Aqui, parte mais frágil não quer dizer
a weaker partner, it doesn't mean spiritually, necessarily. It doesn't mean that necessarily. It means that someone with a more fragile build-up. Because man is more rational, and women is more emotional, anytime there's a conflict, who is more emotional, and sentimental suffer more, is weaker. Here we say, considering, treat them with respect. Meaning what? Meaning to know the worth of the other part. But of course, this is only possible in spirit. If you're not in spirit, we'll be feeling, oh, I don't need it. But what is most important is in this end. Because you are together, heirs with you of the gracious gift of life, this is wonderful. Heirs of the gracious gift of life. So there is a gift of life. So each family has this joint heritage gift. It's not just an individual gift. There is a joint gift, something that God gives for families, for couples. And this that God gives to couples is greater than what is given to each one individually. So you believe there's a special inheritance of God to your family. If you believe so, you'll have to know today what is the inheritance and where is this inheritance. It may not be a doctrine. If anyone asks you, what is the God's inheritance in your family? You may be able to say all things that God deposited in my family, deposited for both, and together with your children. Now, God's enemy wants to destroy this. That's why there are many problems in a family. Two kinds of problems, husband and wife, and parents and children. Husband and wife horizontally, parents and children vertically. And then family becomes extremely fragile. Just as was spoken, God revealed as God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, this God must also be known as your God and the God of your son and the God of your grandson, or the God of your father and the God of your grandfather. There's an inheritance conveyed, transmitted from generation to generation, heirs of the same grace of life. Here we also read that so that nothing will hinder your prayers. So we see something quite important here, that couple prays together. So that will not hinder your prayers. But this is a very important prayer for God's economy. This prayer is very important for God's plan, and also very important for the salvation of the family. This means that will not be hindered. And if you touch the word, what God is telling us, do not hinder. So you have to know something. The enemy will do anything to interrupt, to hinder you from praying. So I have a question. You, dear couples, are you praying together? Are you praying together? If you are not praying together, there is a wide open door for the enemy. And the blessing leaks out. Do not hinder your prayers. Look, then we will cover a very important point, which is in Matthew 18. From verse 18, we read, "Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything they ask for, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven." Look at the importance of prayer of two people. Here we read two people who agree, who are in harmony. Then God will do it. Meaning what? That the couple is a powerful tool that God has to make his plan to be fulfilled on this earth. That's why the enemy wants to destroy families. That's why he wants to destroy the couple's prayer. Here we read two people. Who are the closest two people? The couple, isn't it? Should be, right? The prayer. The most powerful prayer. And it is when they are one. This is what we read in the Word of God. It's not myself. I'd like to ask you this question. Do you believe it or not? If you do, then you will pray. And God will do it. You think God will do it or not? Now think on a number of problems that you have. Now think on something. If I pray with my spouse, it will be an open path. Do you believe it or not? This is God's promise. God's promise failed, no. But then, let me ask you again, are you praying? You have a powerful tool, but you are not using it. Look, saints, how we are very religious. Today was shared something very important in the message tonight. For example, isn't a fact or not that God gave us the best word? It is or not? The best word should produce the best faith. Right?
If
you have the best word, you should have the best faith. The strongest faith. And do we have it? Something is wrong. We do not know to take what we have. A couple of us realize it is possible to receive this best word and to turn that word into faith. In prayer, in action of God, this comes through prayer. And then, an important point in the Bible, look, Peter says, do not hinder your prayers. This is something that we need to be attentive to. Let me just show you a verse here. Daniel 11:31, showing the action of the Antichrist.
Deles sairão forças que profanarão o santuário, a fortaleza nossa, e tirarão o sacrifício diário. O sacrifício diário é a comunhão diária com Deus.
The daily, we'll remove the daily sacrifice. You know what the Antichrist will do in our lives? His armed forces will rise up to desecrate the temple fortress and will abolish the daily sacrifice. So the enemy will abolish the daily sacrifice. If you do not fellowship with the Lord, the action of the Antichrist already happened in your life. It's not of not having time. It's not not having time toward God. You do not pray because the devil already abolished that. It's not that you don't have time, because you do have time. Who gives you time? Is it God or the evil one? God. Why God is giving you time? Why is God giving you time? The time you take out prayer, the enemy says, now the time is mine. I took out their bonds. This couple can no longer be used by God. An atomic bomb was deactivated. You know that the prayer of a couple's prayer is like an atomic bomb. Say to your spouse, we are an atomic bomb. Of course, it's not to blow up your family, okay? It's to blow up the enemy. Power. It's power. And let me tell you something, especially in the end of times where the mystery of iniquity is operating. Don't you feel that the gates of Hades are opened? I believe it was last conference in the fellowship room. We spoke about the importance of heading up for the building to prevail against the gates of Hades. It was somewhere else. Well, this year, dear saints, we need to realize that every day, it's a war. Just a remark here. Paul, in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 6 and 7
diz o seguinte,
says this.
Estou sendo já oferecido por libação e o tempo da minha partida é chegado.
As for me, for I'm already being poured out like a drinking offering, and the time for my departure is near. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, and I have kept the faith. Paul said, I finished my course, finished the race on this earth, and then he says, I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, and I have kept the faith. So he tells us that every day is a day of fight. Life is a continuous struggle. Every day we have struggles. Do you believe that one day the devil will say, no, today I'll leave you alone, I will just return tomorrow? Do you believe that? Do you believe it or not? He works every day. He's trying to get you every day. So you have struggles every day. Let me tell you something. When the couple are joined in prayer for this fight, the victory is there. The victory is present. So many things. We need to have the spirit of struggle, of fought. The couple must realize we are a powerful instrument, a powerful weapon in God's hands against God's enemy and for God's plan, right?
And
my family is important in God's plan.
And
Satan will attack my family.
E nós precisamos estar
and
guardados.
We need to be kept.
Nós oramos.
We pray.
Oramos juntos.
We pray together.
Nós somos um.
We are one.
Olha só.
Look at this.
Eu quero dar uma lida em Efésios.
Let me read Ephesians 6.
Versículo 12.
Verse 12 is very familiar to us all. But our struggle is not against flesh and blood. It's not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. So Paul says that our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world. Let me ask a question to you, dear couples. Are you struggling every day against rulers and authorities?
Ele diz, a nossa luta não é contra carne e sangue. Mas o que acontece?
He says that our struggle is not against blood and flesh. But what happens in your place? Struggling against flesh and blood, right? This happens. Look. We are two. The two of us should be one. Should pray together for God, for God's eternal plan, and to struggle together against the rulers and authorities. He says that our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers and against the authorities. Where is our struggle against the authorities and rulers? Where is it? We spend our time fighting one another, fighting flesh and blood. We were deceived. Isn't time to change? Tonight we have to change it. You cannot look at your spouse as your enemy. You cannot look at your spouse as your problem. God put you two together to fight for him against the rulers and authorities and not against one another.
O
Today, we see families being destroyed, children entering in drugs, daughters entering in homosexualism. This is a very serious problem. Problem of homosexualism in the generation of our children is a very serious problem. We did the survey, dear couples. It is a very high percentage. Did you know this? Very high percentage. And we are fighting against each other while our children are being devoured by the enemy.
And
our family has been destroyed and one fighting against the other, one another. Isn't time to change? It is necessary to have a proper spirit. First Samuel, chapter 17, when David speaks with Saul, verse 34, but David said to Saul, your servant has been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion or a bear came and carried off a sheep from the flock, I went after it, struck it, and rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned on me, I seized it by its hair, struck it, and killed it. Your servant has killed both a lion and a bear. Look at this. David was caring for his father's sheep. Then a lion came, then a bear another time.
He
carried off a sheep from the flock. You know, Satan is like this, crazy to take our children or someone from our family. Take one of the spouses. He carried off. What did David do? David didn't say, oh, it's good that carried off the lamb and not myself. I will be far away. He didn't do that. What did he do? He said, I went after it, struck it, and rescued the sheep from its mouth. Today in your family, where are your children? In the lion's mouth? Saying one thing tonight, it's possible to seize them from the lion's mouth. It is possible to rescue from the lion's mouth. You have to run after it, struck it, and kill it. For this, spirit of struggle, action of the couple. Some brothers are being lost. Imagine several couples praying in one accord before the Lord. Meaning, we will not let the lion to devour him. We will take it out, rescue from the lion's mouth. You see the importance of a couple in God's plan. Our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the authorities and rulers. You may say, oh, it's so hard. My spouse made many mistakes. Then, the matter of forgiveness.
You know, Matthew 6, when the Lord speaks about prayer, teaching prayer to his disciples. Matthew 6, verse 9, we read, "So you pray in this way." After he finishes prayer in verse 13, he says, "Because if you forgive man his offenses, also your heavenly Father will forgive you. If you do not forgive man his offenses, their offenses, your heavenly Father will also not forgive you." Spoke of prayer and then spoke of forgiveness. Not just here, Matthew 18, and that portion we read, that portion speaks that when two agree about anything, will be given by the Father who is in heaven. And verse 20 is important also, because whenever there are two or three gathered together in my name, I'll be among them. So you and your wife, your spouse, your two, you say, "We are the two here in the Lord's name." The word says, "I am among you." When the couple are together, tonight we're here in the name of the Lord. Do you believe the Lord is here? Let me ask you a question. Do you believe he's here, or do you realize he's here? It's different. The fact of believing, I don't realize. When you realize, your attitude changes. Right? The two gathered together in the name of the Lord to pray. The Lord is there. It's not just to believe, but also to realize the Lord is here. One has a problem with the other. He will forgive it or forgive the other or not. What do you think? You can see in verse 20, Peter asked the Lord, "If my brother sin against me, how many times should I forget him? How many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to seven times?" So the Lord spoke of prayer and immediately about forgiveness. Because we all have mistakes and we hurt one another. And these wounds we have prevent us from being one. If we're not one, our prayer loses strength. You may choose to cultivate your sorrow and let the enemy destroy, to forgive, and to become a powerful weapon in God's hands. What do you choose? Or say, "I will cultivate my sorrow," you'll see your family to be destroyed. Or you say, "Lord, I cannot forgive, but I exercise my spirit. I join to you, Lord, be the forgiveness in me." You exercise your spirit, and God put forgiveness in your heart. You forgive, and your family is saved. Which way will you take? Dear saints, in this end of times, the force of the enemy is increasing, but our prayers as couples must be intensified, and we must unceasingly to fight against rulers and authorities. Second Timothy 4:17 says that the Lord assisted me, but
But the Lord stood at my side and gave me strength so that through the message might be fully proclaimed and all the Gentiles might hear it. It was delivered from the lion's mouth. Why? Because I heard the prayer for him. Dear saints, the divine economy includes you, your wife, and your children. Includes your family. And your family needs to become a powerful weapon in God's hands to fulfill His eternal plan. The enemy will do anything to destroy them. But the victory is ours because Christ overcame. Now is the time to turn. Brother Pedro shared about to change our meetings, right? But the change begins at home. Experience the Lord in your home and you will blow up in the meeting. You believe this? What happens? Today, many times, let's go to the meeting, let's go to the meeting there. Always late, then you begin fighting to the meeting place. And then you get the two of you there closed. That's what the enemy wants. The enemy is happy and say, I made them unuseful. This atomic bomb will not work. Okay, good. Imagine in your place, Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, amen, hallelujah. Okay, let's go to the meeting. Then go in your car singing. Oh, happy I am in God's garden. I'm so happy in this lovely place. And then when we get to the meeting, everyone is happy. But it began at home. Why? Because the victory begins at home. And the victory begins with the two being one, saving the whole family. Isn't that wonderful? This is what God wants to our lives, okay? Okay, it's late. Let us finish this with a couple praying together, okay? Pray with a firm decision. Today is the day of change. Today is the day of turnover. Let us not fight against each other. Together, we will fight against the enemy. Okay? May the Lord bless each family and each couple. Jesus is Lord. Amen.